Well, thank you for coming today. If you're taking notes today, the title of this that the Lord had given me, actually through a story that Nona had given me, a testimony, is simply this: no trespassing. No trespassing. Has anyone ever had anyone trespass on your property or on your lawn or anything like that? About 2 years ago, we were coming back from the Dayton revival. Remember, we had revival down at Memorial Hall, and we were there quite a bit, and we had packed everything up because we had to be up, so it was probably about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, and we had the church trailer, and we turned into our little cul-de-sac, which is quiet. I love it. There's not really any traffic, and as I'm driving up, I see some people running, and they were at my neighbor's house. Well, you know me, I don't have a lick of sense. I stopped the car, and here I got a suit on, probably this one. Have a suit on, and no telling what other mechanical items I had on my body. And so I am like literally parked the car. The kids are at Lori. Everyone's in there. And I'm chasing these guys down the road and yelling at them at 2 in the morning. Christian was with me too. Of course, I'm much faster than he is, I'm sure. Right? After 2 knee surgeries, right, I ought to be faster than him, right? So I'm chasing them down the street because they were trespassing. Well, I call the police as I'm running. I was like, I'm chasing these guys down the road. And they're like, what are you chasing guys down the road at 2 in the morning for, right? So I'm chasing them down the road because they were trespassing. And I had thought, I couldn't get a hold of my neighbor. I knew that they were out of town. So I thought they were robbing his place. They were right next to my house. And I'm like, you boy, and I'm yelling at them, you boys better not stop because I'm catching on you. Well, then they ran far, they ran faster. And there's no way I could catch them. Well, they were ding-dong-ditching at 2 in the morning. Well, the police got them. Police got them and brought them to my house. And I'm like loving every minute of this. These poor little high school kids, they're from Miamisburg, had their Miamisburg sweatshirts, baseball sweatshirts on. They're like half handcuffed, and they're just about ready to pee their pants, right? And they were scared half to death. And the officer said, sir, are these the boys? And I looked up in there, and I pulled them to the side. I said, officer, is that really what they were doing, ding-dong ditching? He was like, yeah. And I said, please, I do not want to get anybody in trouble for that, but just scare the liver out of them, right? And so when someone's trespassing, it something wells up within you. Fear wells up. How many have ever had someone to trespass or even break into your house? You've had that? Oh, my word, that's a horrible, horrible feeling. You feel violated. You feel insecure. You don't know, how did they get it? Who's the one who did this? Well, years ago when I was in college, I got hit with trespassing. Right? I had a vehicle, and I want to show you this. This is called Black Thunder right here. This was my truck. This was my truck back in the day, and I still can't. It was the bomb, right? That bad boy, the bed would even tilt up sideways tilt. So it was like a Z, the top can. It was awesome. That's why Lori married me, because I was so awesome, right? She actually wrecked it the very first day that she drove it to work. And the very last thing, because she did, is she locked her keys in the car with it started. And back then, there was no remotes or anything like that. And the last thing that came out of my mouth was, don't wreck it. And that's exactly what she did. She went out and she did it on purpose because she knew I loved this truck. And she was in competition with this truck right here, right? No, stop it. But back when I was in college, they had, how many remember the cruising scene? Anybody would go cruising? Oh my word, you guys have got to get a life, man. And so we would go cruising on Kearney. That was the main road. And it got so bad, people would cruise. They would go in, turn around in Taco Bell, go all the way around McDonald's, just back and forth. Cars and hot rods, and you know, it was harmless. Well, one particular night, I went through McDonald's and I was eating. And you know what you would do is you would get your food and you would park in the parking lot, pointing out to the road, and you would watch the cars go by. Right, and every once in a while, someone get a brave. And back in the 90s, you know, you could do burnouts and all these different things. Anybody, can anyone feel the nostalgia coming forth from me right now? Okay, thank you, Lord. Thank you. I'm making a connection now, right? So I pulled into this, I don't even know, I think it was an upholstery place right beside McDonald's, and I'm not doing anything. I'm just eating my food, and I'm enjoying the night. You know, the top was off the truck, and, we like the cars that go boom and all that stuff. And so we're just sitting there, and next thing you know, the police came and just almost arrested me and have put me in cuffs, and I've got a pickle hanging out of my mouth, you know, just like, what? Well, I didn't even tell my mom. I was like, I got near arrested for trespassing. Well, evidently there'd been some vandalism that went on in his shop, and they had said, anybody that's on my property and it's right there on the road. So it was out in view. No one was out, no one was doing anything. But the owner thought that I was trespassing, and so he brought up charges against me and another guy, Frank Lay was his name, and we had to literally go and stand before a judge. I'm in Bible college! I had to stand before a judge, and I ain't telling my mama nothing because I'd get a whooping when I got home, right? And here I am, I'm 20 years old, right? I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm standing before the judge, and I'm like, I didn't do anything. I had no representation. I had nothing. So they said, oh, this guy came in. Oh, we'll be your representative. And said, oh, yeah, we're guilty. And I'm like, what? I didn't even say anything. I was just eating a hamburger. That's all I was doing. Well, I got put on because I was a good little boy. I got put on 6 months of probation that if I didn't get it would just drop off, right? Well, the owner of the property, he didn't want anyone on his property at all because there had been break-ins. So now I was accused of trespassing, right? How many have ever gotten charged with trespassing before? I am the only one up here chilling like a villain. You know what I'm saying? All right? So trespassing, what it is, it's a legal term for the situation in which one person enters onto the land of another without permission or a legal right to be there. There's a YouTube channel out right now of people literally kind of going through and they're taking videos and they're trespassing and videoing themselves doing it. They're developing the case against themselves and they're entering onto these abandoned farms and they're finding cars and all these different things. Well, it's completely illegal. They're trespassing. If someone wanted to be a jerk about it, they would have to, you know, be fined and be arrested for that. Well, we see in God's word a little bit of trespassing going on. If you grab your copy of God's word, I want you to turn there to Exodus chapter 23. Exodus chapter 23. Now, up until this point, what we have to understand is that the children of Israel had been in Egypt, and God said, you know what? You out, and I'm going to take you to the promised land. And so now they're kind of wandering around in the desert, and you know they didn't go into the promised land the first time. They didn't go in the promised land doing what they're supposed to do, right? They disobeyed God's word, and so they begin to grumble and complain and turn people against God. Well, in Exodus 23, this is a promise that the Lord is giving the children of Israel. Listen, this is what I want you to do. And it says this, worship the Lord your God, and his blessing will be upon your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none of you will carry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full lifespan. Verse 27. I will send terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I will make all of your enemies turn their backs and run. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, the Canaanites, the Hittites out of your way. But I will not drive them out in a single year, because the land would become desolate and the wild animals too numerous for you. Little by little, these are God's promises. He's telling them what he's going to do. Little by little, I will drive them out before you until you have increased enough to take possession of the land. I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, from the desert to the Euphrates River. I will give into your hands the people who live in your land, and you will drive them out before you. Do not make a covenant with them or with their gods. Do not let them live in your land, or they will cause you to sin against me, because worship of their gods will certainly be a snare to you." What we have here is God bringing them out of Egypt, and now after they have done their 40-year penance, now God is saying, listen, I am giving you the land that I have promised you. This is your territory. This is your possession. This is yours. It's been bought for you. I paid it in full, and so this is yours. So now here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to drive out these things. I'm going to take sickness away. I am going to give you a full lifespan. I will send my terror ahead of you. I will make your enemies turn. I will send the hornet ahead of you. I will drive them out. I will establish you. I will give into your hands these people. God said, I'm going to do all these things. As a matter of fact, 8 times God said, I'll do it. 8 times God said, I'm going to do this. And only 1 time did he say, you will drive them out. Only 1 time. Y'all with me here this morning? God has given them territory. God has given them land. God has given them property. And not only is he given it to them, he's preparing the way for them to be established in there. The word of God tells us in praise, Lord, establish the work of our hands. God is setting them up for success. He's doing all of these things. And now in verse in the last part of verse 31, it says, I'm going to do all this. So this is just what I need you to do. You will drive them out. It says right here, I will drive them out. And then it says in verse 31, then you will drive them out. He is already setting the stage and giving them ownership rights. Now all they have to do is kick the trespassers off the land. I've already taken care of it. The arrangements have already been made. Now all you have to do is take possession of it. You just have to kick the enemy out of your land. You see, the Israelites were God's holy possession. And because the Israelites, the children of Israel, they rejected Jesus as the Messiah, now we are grafted into the vine. Now we have been bought with a price. Now the precious blood of Jesus comes in, and now we are his ownership. We are that chosen generation, that peculiar people. Yes, if it wasn't for it's not replacement theology. We're not replacing the Israelites, but God has made a way for you and I to be invited into this. Aren't you thankful for that? Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, it says, you are bought with a price. You were bought with the price. What was the price? Jesus. Jesus' precious blood. Remember John 3:16? God so loved us that he gave his one and only son that whoever, say whoever. That means you and me. Whoever, what? Believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Okay, I'm putting you to the test here today, Spurgeon, right? We got to get rid of this, right? So we are his possession. We are his, right? You see those you see people getting those tattoos that says I am his or I am hers or something like that, and they're too afraid to put a name to it, right? Right? All right, or those T-shirts that they're walking and it has "I am His" and it has an arrow pointing that way and His is pointing this way. Right, it shows that not necessarily that there's ownership, but it shows that I belong to that person. I belong to that person. And the same way is with us. When Christ came down, he bought us with a price, Noni. He bought us with a price. But what we've got to understand that if God bought us, and which he did, he paid for us with his precious blood, that means that we are his, but that also means that anytime the enemy comes on our territory, that means that he is trespassing. Hello? That means that he is trespassing. And so what we've got to do is we've got to constantly guard our hearts and guard our minds. 1 Peter said this, you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. Say, I am chosen. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness and into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you had received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. How can we receive God's mercy? Because we are children of God. We are his. We are his. But how many knows that sometimes, even though that we are his, the enemy comes in and tries to take back what God has already paid for? In the book of Acts, you see that. You see the apostle telling the church, he says in verse 29, I know that after I leave you, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. The enemy tries to gain territory into what is God's. And what we've got to do as believers, we need to learn how to kick the trespasser out. We need to learn how to kick the trespasser out. You see, failure to kick out the trespasser actually gives him ownership of part of the claim, and that is always going to result in coexistence. That's a lot. Listen, when we fail to kick the trespasser out of our lives, right? Okay, let me take a step back so we can get this in bite-sized chunks. Say this is anytime the enemy comes into this little circle right here, anytime, Jesse, I love you, but you're the devil. Come here. Anytime the devil comes in, I have an opportunity to either push him back and away, or if I'm not careful, oh, you look pretty harmless. That's all right. And I don't like it, but you can stay over that portion. But, it's too difficult for me to let go because, man, you look good, right? All right? And so, come on, high five. We're manly enough to say this, all right? If I do not kick the enemy out, if I do not remove the trespasser, what happens then is that I give him part ownership of what God has already taken claim for me. And I learn to coexist with him, and I hate that word. I learn to coexist with the devil because either, number one, I'm too afraid of him to kick him out, or number two, I kind of like having him around. I don't have a problem with it because, well, that thing that used to be sin in my life, it's not that big of a deal. Let me tell you something. The devil won't stick to his part of the bargain and stick over into his side right there, his little square. You know, once you give him an inch, he's going to take a mile. Can I tell you, once you give him an inch, he'll take 100 miles. It won't stay there. He now incorporates and operates in all parts of the territory when we've let him have just one little space and we fail to kick him out. Thank you, Justin. All right? Let's give the devil a hand this morning. That's right. I'm just teasing, right? We learn to coexist with the devil. We don't kick him out. And their statements, especially in battling with our minds, how many have struggled and have this struggle with the battle of the mind? When we fail to kick the devil out, we surrender and we let statements like, I'll never be able to change that. I'll never be able to change that situation. I'm not good enough. Well, they don't think I'm good enough, so my parents said I wasn't good enough, so I don't think I'm going to be able to handle it. And we begin to think things contrary of what God's word says who we are in Christ, and we begin to think it. Situations and scenarios that go on in our mind, situations that actually have happened, now the devil sits down because we've given him room to coexist in our life. Now he sits down, hey, grab some popcorn, I want to show you something, and begin to watch the reel of things that have happened in our past, things that have happened in our present, things that are happening, and things now that even hasn't happened. The devil says, you know what, they're thinking that. They're thinking that. They're saying this about you. And they play this whole picture laid out before you. And if we're not careful, the devil sets up camp in our own minds. Y'all with me here today? You see, surrendered territory will always rob you of faith. Surrendered territory will always rob you of faith. I like this little saying that says, as you think, so you will be. If we think we're not worth it, the result will be behavior that displays that you're not worth it. If you think that, oh, I'm a failure, it's going to result in behavior that resembles someone that is a failure. Y'all with me? You sticking with me? No one's talking to me this day. If you think in your head, well, I'm really not qualified for that job, I'm not qualified for this, it's going to result in behavior that resembles someone who is disqualified. If you walk around living in the shame of your past and you're ashamed of what's going on, things that in your past and the devil, can I tell you, he will always remind you of your past. Always, 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 he'll remind you of your past and your shortcomings and your failures. He'll bring it up to current real time. Current real time. And if you think that you're ashamed of what you're done, it's going to result in behavior that only knows how to live in shame. People who live in shame, they hide. They hide. They hide. They won't get around people. They hide. They're almost like recluse. And what we've got to learn to do is, children of God, we've got to learn to take authority over the enemy and kick him out of the territory that God has already established for us. And that's what I want to talk to just very quickly this morning, of how to kick the devil out of your mind. How to kick the devil out of your mind. And can I tell you, today I'm talking to myself. I was a good little kid. Believe it or not, I never drank, never smoked, chewed tobacco once, felt so convicted, thought the ground was going to open, I was going to go straight to hell. Never did drugs. Never went to parties like that. I was a good little boy. And can I tell you, you fool your mama because she thinks, well, you never went to all that stuff, so you're perfect. Please. Please. I had enough God in me growing up that I was afraid to do anything. I did. I grew up in a legalistic home the very first time I ever went to see a movie, I literally thought the gates of hell were right there and I was going to fall on the ground. Because you didn't go to movies, you didn't cuss, and on top of the cussing, you didn't use bywords. Does anyone know what a byword is? Oh, shucks. I know what you're really meaning. No, I'm really meaning shucks. I mean, that's exactly what it is. Those are bywords. You talk about, I'm going to kick your hiney. You know that. You know what you're talking about. Grandma, she'd come out there and she'd get a switch. You say bywords. How many grew up in a house like that? Hey, we got a few of those. God bless you. You know, I feel your pain, right? And so when you think that you're living your life okay like that, you know, but I'll tell you what, my battle is many times up here. What are people thinking about you? What are people saying about you? Can I tell you, you'll never know what people are saying about you. Joyce Meyer said this best, you don't know what you don't know. Boy, isn't that true? I love that when she says that. You don't know what you don't know. And that'll bring some things into perspective. You don't know what people are saying. You don't know what people are thinking. That's the enemy that you have allowed to come in on your territory and settle up right next to you and begin to coach you on who you are in Christ. Can I tell you, the devil don't need to tell you who you are in Christ. The Word of God will tell you who you are in Christ, right? That you're chosen. He'll let you know that you're the head and not the tail. Oh, the devil, he'll tell you just the opposite. Well, you're not worthy. If the church only knew what you did, the church only knows what you're thinking, the church only knows what this, if the church only knew that you're not paying your full tithe, right? The devil will come in and he'll tell you all these different things and cause you to shrink back. And then the next thing you know, you're not coming to the altar and praying because you don't feel worthy. You're not lifting your hands in worship because I don't want to be a hypocrite. Listen, we've got family members won't lift a hand in worship because they feel like they're being hypocritical. Let me tell you something. The very best place that you can be is in church, raising your hands, lifting your voice up and letting the water of the Word wash you clean. Hello? Letting him wash you. So here's just a few things I want to give you this morning of how to kick the devil out of your mind. Now, when every time, I'm not going to go. I was going to say, every time I say kick the devil, you can kick the seat in front of you, but I don't want to do that. I don't want to hurt nobody. How to kick the devil out of your mind. And it's so very simple, guys. As a matter of fact, I took these six little steps and I put that into practice this week. Because, can I tell you, the greatest thing, I battled this. On a daily basis, I battle this thing right here. Worry and fear, I battle that. You know, you want to pray for your pastor? You cover me with prayer over my mind. And I say, you want to pray for me? That's. Am I right? She knows me better than anybody else, right? So cover me right here. I put these into practice today, and I didn't even need to get to number 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. Just number 1 took care of it. All week long. And can I tell you, the devil will come right back. Once you get victory, he'll come back around the corner and he'll try it a different way. I used the same thing and he hit the bricks, man. He was gone. Every time. Grab your copy of God's Word and I want you to turn to Philippians. You're going to want to take a pen or a highlighter or a pencil or something like that and write it. Or if you've got your e-Bible, you can highlight that right there. These are 6 easy ones right here. Of how to kick the devil out of your mind. And they're found in Philippians. Philippians, it starts with Philippians chapter 4. And the first one is in verse 4. I never had to go to number 2 because this one took care of it. It says this. How to kick the devil out of your mind. Number 1, rejoice. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Somebody read it with me. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. We'll do it again. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. What we find is this. Anytime you lift your mind up and you lift your spirit up and out of your mouth comes praises to our God, the devil cannot tolerate that. You see, when you're going through situations, when you're going through circumstances, when the devil is all up in your mind and he's telling you things that are not true, because can I tell you, there's no truth in anything that he says. That's what the Bible says. He's the father of lies. There's no truth in him. It's been that way since the beginning. Well, what if it's a partial truth? Let me tell you something. A partial truth is still a lie. And so here the devil comes and he's whispering in your ears. I put this to the test and I caught myself. I caught myself this week trying to entertain this and trying to figure out it. And all of a sudden it came back to me again. What is the first thing that you're supposed to do? Rejoice. And all of a sudden, walking down these halls here at the church this week, walking, whether it be in my garage or my house, something would come to my mind and the devil would become to try to take territory. And all of a sudden I stopped. I sang the same verse over again. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. That's all I sang all week long. And guess what? He gone by the first rejoice. And I am not kidding you, friends. If we will learn to rejoice in the victory that God has given us, this is our territory. This is our territory. This is our territory that's bought with the blood of Jesus. So when the trespasser comes in and tries to speak things into your mind, think things into your mind that should not be there, things from your past, things from your present, telling you that you're not worthy, can I tell you, begin to rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Someone said this, that when the devil comes in and he can tell, he didn't know, can I tell you this? I'm an avid believer that the devil doesn't know everything that you're thinking. It's always on the display of what you do and how you respond, right? Now, the Lord is different. The Lord is omnipresent. He's omniscient. He knows where you are and he knows what you're thinking because as a Christian, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. He knows what's going on all the time. The devil don't have access to that, right? But when he does, it's because we've given him room to come in. We give him a little room. We left a little window open. We left the basement door open, something. He comes in, and what happens is we listen to that little thing that's in our whispering, that's in our ear, and the next thing you know, we are surrounded and we're overwhelmed by things that he says. And the next thing you know, once it gets into your mind and you don't take captive, all of a sudden your demeanor, your spirit begins to shrink. spirit of depression, a spirit of heaviness comes over you and you don't know how to operate. You don't know how to function. And instead of doing what God's word says to do, which is rejoice in the Lord always, I say it again, rejoice. What happens is we learn to coexist with that for that season. We entertain it. We entertain those thoughts. That someone's doing this to me and someone's doing that to me and all these different things. The boss isn't going to see what I did and all these different things. Can I tell you? We get that in our head and the next thing you know, we're so down and we're so depressed that we can't even function. But the Bible even has an antidote for that. That we're to put on a garment of praise for a spirit of heaviness. So it really comes all the way back to rejoicing again. The antidote to kicking the devil out is to simply rejoice. That's why when Jesse is up here, he's trying to get you to praise. Come on, let's get past the way. If we can get you to praising, if we can get you to lift up your voice, if we can get you to lift up a hand or two, if we can get you to close your eyes, if we can get you to participate with your brothers and sisters, and all of a sudden the Spirit of the Lord comes, friends, can I tell you, walk out of these exit signs different from which you came in. You'll be changed, you'll be renewed, you'll be restored, and it all starts with rejoicing. Hello? We could stop with that, but I will tell you, we're going to go on. The second thing is this. If you want to kick the devil out of your mind, you number one, rejoice, but number two, you walk softly. You walk softly. Now, I caught myself, and I did use a little bit of this, because this week, Philippians 4:5, it says this, let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. Now, I will tell you this, in battling with your mind, you can be cruel, and you can say things to someone without even saying it, because you're saying it to them in your mind. Hello? You know what I'm talking about? You're dealing with people, you're dealing with situations, and you're letting them, you're giving them whatnot, and you haven't even spoke to them. You are loading the guns in preparation for what you think is coming. And the devil's setting that whole thing up. And can I tell you, you can back away from that, and instead of entertaining that, let your gentleness, let your peace come back to you. Let that gentleness of the Holy Spirit walk with you and take captive. The Bible talks about it, to take captive every thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and make it obedient unto Christ. That's paraphrase version, right? So let your gentleness be evident to all. But can I tell you, to all is to you too. Don't entertain thoughts of aggression. Don't harbor, because all that does is get you stirred. And I even this week, I struggle with that. We're dealing with a situation right now within the family that there's some injustice going on. What I call injustice. Accusation, just dumb, and talking about people's character. And so here on the other side, if I will allow the enemy to come in, because can I tell you, he gives you some good stuff to say. Hello? Right? I mean, he's good at what he does. He gives you good stuff to say. And you know, the only way you're going to get to take out the werewolf in your life is you got the silver bullet. Mm-hmm. And I know if I say this, you know, ding dong, the witch is dead, the wicked witch is dead, right? It's taken care of. And so if you will entertain that, all you're doing is you're learning to coexist with the devil because he's given you good ideas. But the Bible says this, to let your gentleness be evident to all. Can I tell you, if you're allowing the Holy Spirit to work in you, gentleness, when those situations possibly do arrive in your life, you're going to be so walking with the Holy Spirit that it's going to come out of you. But when you've got anger and bitterness and you've got this, it will exude from your very being. It will just pour out. It'll come out of your pores. Anger and bitterness and just seething anger. All right, so you with me? If you want to kick the devil out of your mind, rejoice. But number two, you got to learn to walk softly. Walk softly in your spirit. Number three is this. You got to keep calm. You want to kick the devil out of your mind? Keep calm. How many of you ever lost your marbles before? How many still have not found a few of them that you lost them, right? All right? Oh, we got some pointing going on over here. Hey, well, we hadn't lost the marbles, right? Right? We got a few that we found that we can give to you. You can pick those up, right? Keep calm. What does the Bible say in verse 6a? Philippians 4, 6a. It says this, do not be anxious about a few things. No, it says about anything. Don't be anxious about anything. Boy, can I tell you this, if there's a sermon made for me, it's made for me. Don't be anxious. Listen, I've driven myself halfway to the hospital because of anxiety attacks. Because of I've let the devil come into my territory and I didn't kick him out. Halfway there, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me. You know, that still small voice is a shouter sometimes. Pull that car over. What are you doing? I'm going to the hospital. You're not having a heart attack. This is the sin that's going on in your life right now. I turned the car back around and I went back to the church, right? I'm like, okay, Lord. And I made it right. I made it right with the brother that I had wronged. I made it right. You see, don't be anxious about anything. You got to keep calm. Keep calm in your spirit. Number four, and we do this. We kind of get these, you know, we go for the number four is pray. But in every situation, by prayer and petition. Pray. Pray. I'll tell you what. But here's what I found. I see people praying all the time, but they're not rejoicing. They're not walking softly, and they're not keeping calm. I'll tell you what, you can take some things out of order and you can take some things out of context and still be wrong in doing it. Hello? But in every situation, say every situation. By prayer and petition, we got to pray. We have to pray. Look at this, number five. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6c. With thanksgiving, present your request to God. Well, how many know when you got something that's going on in your life, the last thing you want to do is to give thanks? And that crazy song, give thanks with a grateful heart, right? Oh, come on. That's the worst song when you don't feel like it. That's the worst song to sing, right? You don't want to give thanks. God, I don't want to give thanks. God, get them. That's the way we want to pray. And we all of a sudden we become a son of thunder. Lord, let fire come down. You know, we all want to pray the Elijah prayer. Listen, if you and I had the power of Elijah, there wouldn't be anybody left in the face of the earth. Someone pulls out in front of us. Let me tell you something. We were on our way. This was awful. We were on our way down to Atlanta just a week and a half ago. On our way down to Atlanta, and this dude literally came, and, you know, I'm a safe driver. We came across all the lanes of traffic, pulls in front of me, and slams on his brakes while he's holding his cell phone. There was a spirit that came over me, and it wasn't from God. And let me tell you something. I hit the gas in that Suburban. You see that moose? I hit the gas. I didn't hit the brakes. I hit the gas. Pulled right up next to that dude. I rolled down that window. Godly man that I am. The anointing flowing. Let me tell you something. If you get a big bald man with a goatee yelling and screaming at you, you're going to back off real quick. And that's exactly what he did, right? You want to be intimidating? Shave your head, grow one of these, all right? It's all good. And I yelled at him, put down your... I mean, I just... Veins are popping out of my neck. That dude backed up. He went back about four lanes of traffic. Let me tell you something. There wasn't no giving thanks in any of that. Right? When someone crosses you, you want to give it to them. Right? Come on. And I did. And then right after that, I'm like, Lord, I'm sorry. I give thanks to you, Lord. Never close your eyes and lift up your hands while you're trying to drive either. That's no good. Right? We got to learn to give thanks. Give thanks. Present your request to God. Give him thanks. God, I thank you. God, I don't, you know, and you can pray like this, even though you're in the midst of a situation that's horrific, even though you're in a situation that you cannot control, even though you're in a situation that your mind is running and it's hard to even believe that the Lord is going to work it out. Learn to give thanks. Father, I thank you because I know that you're in control of all things. Begin to give him thanks. God, I thank you. And if you can't give him thanks for what's going on right now, begin to recall. Remember that old hymn, count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God. Give him thanks. Give him thanks in the midst of your situation. God, I don't know what you're trying to do, but God, I thank you because you love me enough to walk me through this because I am not alone. Give thanks. You can find things to give God thanks for even in the midst of the most horrific circumstance. And the last one, number six, and I like this one, and you're going to like it too. Philippians 4, verse 7, what does it say? And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and what?
Minds.
Number six, the sixth step, watch God work. Watch God work. You remember with the children of Israel? They're going in the land, and God said, I will. I'll send the hornet. I'm going to make this. I'm going to make this happen. It's all going to be good. You're going to be walking in health. I will do all these things. I will drive them out before you, but I won't do it too fast because I know if I do it too fast, God has every detail worked out. And all we had to do is once God did his part, he said, now, listen, I've done my part. Now you do your part. And can I tell you with this? Just rejoice in the Lord. Do your part, and God will always do his. But how many know that there's a difference between kicking the devil out of your mind and keeping the devil out? What I find is that when we come to church, and I'm just crazy to believe this, Tammy, when we come and we come to an altar and we come to, with someone, we agree with someone, Chuck, in prayer, and we lay hands and we just confess in the name of Jesus, I believe that it's done right then and there. I believe that it is done. And I've seen many people, they get relief in their spirit and they go, but there's a difference between kicking the devil out and keeping him out. And it's found in the very next verse. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. This is now how to keep the devil out. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure. You're not even watching the screen, all right? Okay, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. If anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Now listen, let's use some good old-fashioned logic here. If I come and I come to an altar and I kneel down and God does some awesome things in my life and he breaks chains and my mind is free and now I'm believing what God's word says about me and I get up, but I go right back out and I enter back into the same patterns of living that I had before, it's inevitable that the devil is not going to keep away. He's going to come right back in. There's a difference between kicking him out and keeping him out. Hello? Have you seen that before? Someone come and they've got a problem with alcoholism and they've got a problem with some sort of addiction and they come and there's freedom. You know that there's freedom, but they go right back into the same habits and they go back into the same patterns. And the next thing you know, they're back on again. I've seen it many, many times. But the same way goes with our minds. You can't expect to come to these altars and get freedom from Christ, but enter back in the same pattern of thinking as before. And many times we let it in right through the television. Right through the television, watching things or letting things grab a hold of our emotions that shouldn't be here. And the next thing you know, you're living in scenario, you're living in drama, you're living in circumstances, and all of a sudden you bring that right back on yourself again, which nullifies the victory that you've just received. God helped you through the power of the Holy Spirit get free and kick the devil out, but we left the door wide open to come right back in. don't think anybody's listening to me today. Listen. Romans chapter 12 tells us this. Don't copy the behaviors and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. There's only two people that are amening. Come on, this is for reals. This is for real, friends. Don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by the way you think. Then you will learn to know what God's will is for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Hebrews goes on to tell us this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, it says this, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us. Let us throw off. Throw it off. If the way that you've been thinking, the patterns of the way you're thinking isn't doing you any good, well, change it. Change what you're listening to. Change what you're entertaining. Change the I can't even, I will tell you this, I cannot watch new stuff. I can't. It disturbs me so much in my spirit because all it does is brings up a spirit of anger. Well, Pastor, you need to, this is supposed to be righteous indignation and you're supposed to, can I tell you this? I know where the hot buttons are and I can't watch it. Doesn't matter if it's CNN, Fox News, MSNBC. I can't watch any of that. Debating and all these different stuff and gun control and all these different, I can't do it because all of a sudden the logic in me gets mad and it gets in my spirit. Radio talk stuff, I can't do it. I personally cannot do it because it robs me of the territory that God has given me. And I have to guard it. I have to constantly be going around and guarding what the Holy Spirit has given. And all of a sudden, if I see a breach of some kind, I got to go find him, kick him out, and I got to repair that breach. I cannot allow that to happen in my spirit because guess what? I don't want to lose any anointing. I don't want to lose anything that would cause me to lose faith in people and lose faith in the sight of God. I don't want to do anything like that that would cause anyone else to stumble. I got to throw off everything. I have to guard the music. This is just me personally. I have to guard the music that I listen to. I have to guard the things that I watch on television because if I don't, if you watch something, whether it's a mystery or something like that, can I tell you, that gets deep in your spirit. And it's almost like the fear of what they were experiencing there. That's why Hollywood is so good. Right? That's why they're good at what they do. All of a sudden, they can take you and bring you into a story to where it grabs a hold of your emotions and it changes the way you think. Anybody with me? Finally, this. Can I have someone? Yeah, Brother Daniel. Ephesians chapter 6. This is the last one we're going to do. We're going to wrap this up. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. We're talking about how to keep the devil out. Not to kick him out. We already covered that. How to keep him out. How to maintain the victory in your mind. How to maintain that. And can I tell you, it's still a daily battle that you're going to have to fight. Because if the devil can get into the way you think, it'll change the whole way you act. Ephesians 6 verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Everybody say, put on. Put on the full armor of God. Notice God didn't say, I'm going to put that on you. God didn't say, listen, I want you to stand there and I'll be the butler and I'll help you get dressed. Right? Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, authorities, powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, and here it is, so that when the day of evil comes, not if, but when, because he's coming, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, stand. Stand. Stand your ground. I know that there are many in this room that are like me, that you've struggled with that battle of the mind and things of the past. And can I tell you, I'm not going to say you don't need to live like that. I'll say, you know what? We don't need to live like that. Because I struggle with that too. We don't need to live like that. The Bible tells us that when the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. And that's a pretty big freedom the last time I checked. Today, there's some of you in this room that you're struggling with the battle of that mind. And I will tell you this, the Lord's desiring that you come, and He'll help you kick them out. But it's up to us to keep them out. Amen? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Let me ask you this morning. Would there be anybody here today that you would be honest with yourself and honest before the Lord, and you would say, Pastor, I need to give my life to Jesus. I don't know necessarily what all that means, but I've got to surrender my life to Him. And I need Him this day. I would like to ask Him to come into my heart. I want to ask Him. Today's the day I want to make it right. Is there anyone here? You just slip up your hand and say, Preacher, that's me. That's me. Considering that we're all believers here today, let me ask you this question. How many's been fighting this battle of the mind? Who? My. Yeah, a lot of people in this room. I wonder, for the next few moments, could we do this? Could we make our way to an old-fashioned altar? And could we surrender these things to the Lord? Surrender these things, and if we can learn to simply implement the Word of God and what it tells us to do, to rejoice, right? Start with rejoicing. If we can learn to do that and implement these things in our life, boy, I'll tell you what, Roy, things would go a lot better for us, wouldn't it? So let's all stand across this place.